And it was Mickey Stevenson who was to hire a group of musicians who would play on almost every record Motown released. The Funk Brothers. But Gordy was a black businessman operating in a white-dominated industry. His masterstroke was to hire a man who knew that industry inside out.
I was the first white person that was brought into Motown. I had the knowledge of a record industry. We had a great combination. I had no interest in going into the studio whatsoever. Barry had no interest as far as the marketing or the sales of the records. And we came out together great.
One group of youngsters who were desperate to be part of this success were three teenage girls from the Brewster Projects, a working-class estate in downtown Detroit. Diana Ross, Florence Ballard, and Mary Wilson.
The one thing about the Supremes is that I always felt that we together made one perfect human being. We were totally different. Myself being sort of like a middle person, very calm, I used to be. Florence was a very sort of soulful, earthy, extremely earthy girl. Didn't take any stuff from anybody, okay? Diane was very, always kind of fun and play, very, very playful. When we auditioned for Mr. Gordy, we sang all of the songs that we loved. We were just so thrilled and we just knew we had done a great job, you know? And then Mr. Gordy said, well, you girls are really good.
I liked them a lot and they wanted me to sign them right away. And I said, well, not until you finish high school.
We were like, what? We couldn't quite understand why he wouldn't sign us, you know. Then years later, we found out that he was just concerned. We were young girls, just barely 16, and he just didn't want to have anything to do with, you know, underage girls. And I recall leaving the studio, and I remember Florence saying, he couldn't be so smart if he didn't recognize how great we were.
But the Supremes were nothing if not persistent.
Of course, they came back to the studio, and they learned everything they could. And when the semester was up, we signed them.
Florence Ballard chose the name The Supremes, but after a string of unsuccessful recordings, the group became more commonly known as the No-Hit Supremes, despite achieving a modest success with a song written by Gordy himself.
Let Me Go the Right Way was one of those records that we really thought was going to be a hit. I think what we really liked about it was that it was soulful. And, you know, we, like everybody else, were black and wanted something soulful. You know, it was like that was going to be our hit record. And it did do a little bit locally, I think. But it just didn't go hit the charts and go all the way.
But if Gordy couldn't rely on the No-Hit Supremes, his other investments were proving a better bet. Nothing you can say could tear me away from my guy. Nothing you can do, cause I'm stuck like glue to my guy. I'm sticking to my guy like a stamp to a letter, like birds of a feather. We stick together. I'm telling you from the start, I can't be torn apart from my guy.
Nothing you can say can take me away from my guy. No handsome face can ever take the place of my guy. You know what I mean? It was just easy to remember. And it had a rhythmic to it that you could always just sing along with, you know?
And it was these sing-along, easy-to-remember and feel-good lyrics that seemed in perfect tune with the aspiration and optimism of the times. And I'm calling you a better.
there was a strong air of optimism about race relations in the United States. People thought this society would be thoroughly integrated by the end of the 1960s. And there was a great sense of commitment on the part of younger black people. There seemed to be change in the air. Then we got this young president in 1960, John F. Kennedy, who was attractive, and he seemed to have some sympathy for African Americans. Take my hand from my God. My God. No
handsome face could ever take the place of my God. You could say that JFK, I think you could say that Martin Luther King, I think you can say that, and the music and the sound of Motown were all synonymous. And I think it took all of these things to kind of wake the world up to, hey, we got to care more about one another and give us all some understanding.
And no song represented the myriad peoples of the world and Motown's attitude better than Mickey Stevenson's anthem, Dancing in the Street.
I think it's like an anthem for all dance music. It's like the grandfather for all dance music. And it's gone from generation to generation because of the feeling, again, the feeling that connects with the human psyche or the human spirit, I should say. No matter what race or color or whatever, it just grabs you, you know. And that's what makes it, I guess, such a phenomenon.
When I first heard it, I didn't like it. I didn't feel it. And after singing it my best the first time and not having a machine on, a little bit of rage came in the second delivery, but it's an exciting rage, and one that sometimes producers will do that. I don't know if they did it intentionally or what, but they got a good performance out of me.
The right voice, the right arrangement, the Funk Brothers, everything seemed to be gelled for the song, and it all came together in such a way that it was just spirit-driven.
Gordy had now found the perfect formula to ensure that his music was played not only on black radio stations, but more importantly, on white ones too.
I think one of the great reasons for the great success of Motown was that they crossed over to white radio. Once Motown discovered that white radio looked at their records as white records rather than black records from the ghetto, they built on that and made their sound more and more acceptable to the white radio.
What Gordy had done was to transform Detroit from the Motor City into its new incarnation as the Music City. From the Motor City into its new incarnation as the Music City. Just up the road in Chicago, Detroit's legendary rival, no such transformation was necessary. Chicago had a rich musical history. Black workers had migrated here throughout the 20th century and brought with them their own music, the blues.
I came from the South, and a lot of people migrated from the South to Chicago. And we all settled right in that area on the South Side, and music was very important. I think music was probably our way of escaping some of the realities that were going on.
Raw, dangerous, and intense. This was music that was never played on white radio. I'm a tanky, buzzing round. And since the 1940s, Chicago had had its own hugely successful label, Chess Records, founded by Polish immigrants Phil and Leonard Chess.
We primarily were a blues record company, starting in 1947, Chess beginning in 1950. Artists like Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, Howling Wolf, we had them all. We were the best label in Chicago. Chess was the best, there's no doubt.
But by the early 1960s, the blues market seemed old-fashioned and irrelevant to a new generation of aspirational black society. Chicago was changing, and it needed music that reflected that change. it needed. So.
Oh, sometimes I get a good feeling, yeah.
When I came over to Chicago,